and welcome to The Future Report, a podcast hosted by social research company McCrindle for anyone curious about the future. My name is Ashley Fell, and each week I'll be sitting down with a guest to discuss a topic or trend that you need to know about. A major event like a pandemic can cause a reassessment of life. From the Great Resignation that we discussed in our last episode to our relationships, our job, where we choose to live, and even, of course, what we consider to be important, many aspects of our life are being reassessed. So in today's episode, we are going to talk about what people are reevaluating in light of the pandemic and as we emerge from various lockdowns, why a major event like this does cause us to reevaluate things in our life, and how a greater sense of meaning can impact our well-being, mental health, and also the future generations. And joining me today to discuss this topic is Mark McCrindle. Mark, welcome back to the Future Report podcast.
Thanks, Ashley. Great to be with you.
It's certainly a very interesting, very relevant topic that I'm sure many people are experiencing. We've had lots of chats about it in the office with our team. I've had lots of chats about this sort of topic just with people as we reflect on our experience of the last couple of years. And before we get sort of delve deep into this topic of people reevaluating their life in light of all the changes that we've experienced in the last few years, I wanted to ask you about any pre-pandemic maybe habits that you think you might be happy to sort of see go in light of all the change we've experienced.
Well, for me, it was probably just the busyness of life, particularly that circulates around children. And for Ruth and I, we were just sort of nonstop pre-pandemic, dropping kids here, there, and everywhere. You know, not just school, but all the after-school activities. Sport takes up, you know, much of a Saturday. You've got some nights of the week, tutoring or lessons, parties and events, and with the traffic around the place, rushing kids here, there, and all over was pretty intense. And I know that we as parents weren't alone in that. So to have the pause on that, and as we moved back from the pandemic and the lockdowns, picking up some of those things, but not all of those things, was a great delight. So to slow down on the intensity was good. And, you know, I think that it provided more balance for us. And the kids probably were oversubscribed anyway. You know, I don't think they have missed too much of what we didn't pick back up. But I've got the sense that that's the case here, you know, across households around Australia. So perhaps the pruning of things from our lives and getting to a more sustainable pace was something that COVID brought and that we were happy to sort of let go that pre-COVID intense business.
And so many Australians have, I think, really appreciated that. And we talk about, you know, the experience of the last 2 years for many people being really tragic, and we never want to gloss over that in any way. But we also acknowledge that the last couple of years has really provided more time for many people, like you mentioned, Mark. And we wanted to ask Australians how they felt about, you know, some of the practices that they've employed in their life as a result of lockdowns and the pandemic that they want to continue moving forward. And our research found that it was spending more time with family and household members, like you mentioned, enjoying a slower pace of life as well, and more creative hobbies and cooking and baking and board games. And some of those return to, in some ways, a simpler life. People want to keep that moving forward. And I think that really does play into what we're seeing now and what we're going to talk about today in terms of reevaluating things and how that sense of meaning and purpose can really contribute to our life and our well-being, and not wearing that busyness as a badge of honor anymore. And we've talked, I think, before on the podcast and also offline, Mark, you know, even about the fact that we haven't been traveling, and you and I are used to traveling a lot and getting on planes and being interstate, and even just not having that in your life. While we're looking forward to the day when we can do that again, it does provide you with more opportunities to be around family and yeah, for kids and the busyness, certainly a time of rapid change.
Yeah, well, that's right. And it was just such a phenomena, you know, that this pandemic and the impacts that it had. And to think about meaning and a life of purpose is a great thing. And COVID has sort of, pre-COVID, we probably had a life. We just had all the things that we had in our life. But now we get a chance, as we have a bit more of a blank page, to curate a life, to think, well, do I want to put that back in? Because now I'm making a deliberate decision. I didn't just inherit it. I'm not just doing it because I've always done it. And now I'm either choosing to put it back in, to pick it up again, or I'm choosing, you know what, to leave it because it's not there at the moment. And that is just a unique situation that right around the world, so many have that we wouldn't have had should it not have been for this lockdown experience.
Mm, and I was talking to a colleague of mine earlier today about just the busyness in the lead up to Christmas and the Christmas season and all the events. And I think that's also compounded by the fact that when we come out of lockdown, we're making up for lost time in some ways, where things that might have happened in those few months that we were locked down, people have rescheduled to the weekends. And we were saying, you know, it's like you want to be in charge of your weekend and your time, because that's what we've had for the last few months. But now, as you get invited to more events and more social activities, that busyness can so quickly creep back in. But you're so right in terms of we can curate our life, and we have had this reset in some ways. And so it is an opportunity to do that. And I guess, Mark, when we think about this reevaluation of priorities that has come, what are your reflections on why? Why does a pandemic like we've experienced and we are still experiencing, we are still living in, cause us to reevaluate what is important to us in life?
Well, because it provided a full stop to everything that we were doing. It wasn't so much a pause. You know, a weekend is a pause in life. A holiday is a pause. The end of each year is a bit of a pause, and then we get back into what we had. But this was a full stop, because it did, in a sense, end the life that we knew it, and it cleared the decks in terms of it being an extended stop to what we had, an unplanned stop. We couldn't have predicted it, and a universal stop. So everyone was in the same boat. And it was an almost complete stop to almost every activity that we had. And so the rhythms and the cycles of life and activity that we knew was no more. And that's why it was so profound in its opportunity that it presented to re-examine our life. And even the least reflective people, even those that, you know, aren't given much to assessing or looking over their lives, we're in this situation where, well, you had to, because the life that we had had a full stop after it. So that was one of the incredible outcomes of what we've just lived through. And it's a healthy thing. It was 2,500 years ago that Socrates said, an unexamined life is not worth living. That's a pretty strong statement, but in so many ways, it's true. You know, there's no real point in just doing what we're doing and just going through the cycle. Surely to stop and to reflect, to analyze, to weigh up, to deduce as to what we're doing in life and where we're headed is a healthy thing. And that's what it caused. A lot of us pre-COVID had full calendars, but there's a big difference between a full calendar and an impactful calendar. And by extension, there's a difference between a full life and a meaningful life. And surely we would all choose the meaningful life, not just the full one. And so that's what the opportunity that we now have before us to reassess, to look at, to consider, and to move forward with a little bit more determination and prescription as to what we want from the days we're given.
Mm. And I reflect on what you're saying, and it's so true that it was really that extended period of time, because as I reflect on the experience of the last couple of years and even how it's different, like you said, to a holiday, you know, we do get breaks, we do get rest, you do get moments to step out of your regular routine or rhythm, but for that longer period of time, for many of us, that's the first time that's ever happened in our whole life. And so it makes sense as to why it's been so transformational. And like you mentioned, an opportunity to be intentional moving forward about our yes and our no and what we commit to, and like you said, how we fill our calendar, because it is so easy for it to become so full without you being intentional about it, especially in busy seasons and busy times like we are in at the moment leading up to Christmas. Okay, so if we're thinking about reevaluating, and I alluded to that earlier, some of the different areas of life, relationships, work, what do you feel like, what can you add to that list in terms of what people are reevaluating at this time?
Well, everything, you know, in terms of what we're doing for a job, where we're working, where we're living. The finances of life have all been reassessed. People have cut back on spend. It's been forced upon them because they couldn't spend, but also looked at the income side, looked at their debt and whether they're comfortable or not with that. And that's what's driven much of the relocation, much of the change in our household situation and that massive internal mobility across Australia and right around the world. And so, you know, every aspect, the relational areas, of course, not just the financial or the vocational or the social, all areas have been reassessed. And so it has been this in-depth analysis of life and its components, and that's been the amazing thing of it. If we think about how people assess a life well lived, or indeed what the measure of life and success is, there are three A's that come to mind, and people often fall into these categories. There's some people, it's the A for accumulations, and so it's what you have. That's what life's all about. For others, it's the A for accomplishments, and it's what you achieve that really determines whether life has been successful or not. There's a third A that many fall into, and that's just the A for activity. It's what you do. And if we think about those, the accumulations or the achievements or the activity, none of those really define a life of meaning, a life of purpose. You can have lots of stuff, you can tick lots of boxes and have a busy calendar, and yet amidst all of that fullness, there's not real meaning, and it's not a sense of a life that had that great meaning. There's probably a couple of other categories that people might fall into in terms of their priorities of life. And one is a life of reflection, where they do look back and make sure that they're choosing the deeper things, not the shallower ones, and the meaningful ones, and not just the superficial ones. A life where reflection governs choices and decisions, and a life of relationships. That's the final of these five. It's, in other words, not what you have, what you achieve, what you do, but it's where you belong, to whom you belong. And those relationships are so key. And that's what we've seen and in our research of Australians, that the relationships became a priority. The reflections and the life of filled with a bit more purpose and impact rose to the top. And that's been great to see. We did some research a few years back, actually, you might remember, looking at funerals, and particularly how Australians are organising those funerals and the songs that they're playing at their funeral. What are the most requested songs? Because it's almost like the one's theme song, the song that's requested there to be played at our final send-off. And we found three categories, which was interesting to me. The number one category, the most popular, were sentimental songs. And I think at the top of the list, there was Pharrell Williams' Happy, and Somewhere Over the Rainbow was on the list. So a sentimentality can drive this poignant time of life. Religious songs were the second one, and they traditionally were the number one category. They've slipped to number two, but a sense of spiritual meaning and purpose. Amazing Grace was the number one song in that category. Highlighting a focus on not just the temporal, but the life to come. There was a third category, though, which was quite strong, which was, we put in the category of these defiant songs, and the anthem, the number one there, was Frank Sinatra's I Did It My Way. And to me, it was quite telling of how many people live life and, I guess, want to reflect on that life. It's go back to the 1960s when Sinatra first sung that song, and it was peak individualism. It was this rugged determinism of being in charge of one's own direction. The opening stanza of that, he says, and now the end is here, and so I face that final curtain. My friend, I'll make it clear. I'll state my case, of which I'm certain. I've lived a life that's full. I've traveled each and every highway, and more, much more. I did it my way. So this sense that that life was about having no regrets and take it or leave it. I'm not going to reflect. I'm not going to apologize. This has been my life. We've seen a change from that. And that attitude, which might have peaked in the 1960s and 70s in that generation, has changed to one that is a little bit more subtle and reflective and seeking not just the things of the here and now, but the spiritual and the relational and the giving back and the purpose and the meaning. So there's nothing these days that's that people are shy about when it comes to seeking deeper meaning, purpose, and reflection. It's been a generational change, and we're a long way from the 1960s in that sense.
Absolutely. And even what you were talking about there, Mark, in terms of the regrets, you know, I do remember that research about funerals, which again, so fascinating in the context to look at what is of value to Australians when they are thinking about their funeral. And in a similar sort of vein, we ran some research a couple of years ago about people's top regrets. And this is actually right before 2020. So on the cusp of COVID, obviously we had no idea at the time we were running this research, but as I reflect on it, it's just fascinating as well. And the top answer that people strongly agree with in terms of if they had their life again, what would they have done? And the top response was that they would have worried less about what others thought of them, followed by spent more time with family, and then 23% saying they would have wanted to achieve more. They strongly said they would have wanted to have achieved more. So it is interesting in these times of massive societal change, and we've spent a lot of the time on this podcast so far talking about the different aspects of society that are changing as a result of the pandemic, work and relationships and how we shop and becoming more digital. In these times of massive change, it makes sense that we do reevaluate what is important to us. And it is a positive story, I think, as you mentioned, that we are moving a little bit away from that individualistic, maybe I did it my way, to more reflective and introspective as we evaluate, what we want our life to look like moving forward after just spending so much time in areas of change. And when I think about the different facets that make up human beings, and we wrote about this in the Work Wellbeing book because we take a holistic view of the idea of wellbeing, I wanted to ask if you could kind of elaborate, I guess, in terms of with people reevaluating what is important to them in this renewed search of meaning, how a sense of purpose and meaning does enable us to have well-being in our life.
Yeah, it's so important because how we're feeling in life does even impact on our health. That mental well-being massively impacts our physical well-being, and I'm sure we're all aware of, you know, the psychosomatic link that the psyche, the mind, can cause if we're not looking after ourselves there, if we're stressed, if we're anxious, can cause physical ailments, the soma or the body. And that's been a long established link. And so it is important that we deal with anxiety, that we don't have unmanageable stress, that we can solve relational tensions, that we can work in a place of flourishing where we're thriving mentally, where we're refreshed in terms of that psychological well-being, because that will help us physically in that general health and well-being. So I think those links are key, and that's why, you know, with our discussions on well-being, we do take that holistic perspective. We're in a mental health pandemic in Australia. Forget the COVID one. You know, it's the psychological one that's big, and that of course has impacts around physical well-being and social well-being as well. But maybe we could extend that word beyond just the psychosomatic and say it's the pneuma psychosomatic, and pneuma being the Greek word for breathe or spirit or soul. And we know that if spiritually or from just a soul perspective, we're broken, the heart, as it's often described metaphorically, if we've got problems there, then there's going to be a link there mentally and a link there physically as well. And this is sort of known even back to, you know, Greek times and earlier, the sense that body, soul, and spirit, or we might say mind, body, and spirit do need to be, we do need that holistic health, because otherwise it's going to have those implications in more tangible areas. As the ancient book of Proverbs, there's a good proverb that says, a joyful heart is good medicine, but a broken spirit dries up the bones. And that was written about 3,000 years ago. So the link between the physical issues and the spiritual and psychological ones have had a long awareness and connection. And we've got a new generation that's far more tuned into those things today. And I think that's great that their well-being is not just about doing some stretching and going for a walk or a run, but they know that psychologically, you know, spiritually, relationally, socially, they need to look after themselves holistically to bring that true well-being in their life.
Mm, absolutely. And as you were, again, sharing that answer there, I was reflecting on some research, again, that we conducted last year, because we were finding in our studies that we conducted, a lot of people were saying it's a massive time of change. I fully acknowledge that. And so we were, you know, hypothesizing that that would cause a lot of people to reflect on their own life. And we've seen that play out, as we said, with people reevaluating their work and reevaluating finances and health. And that's kind of all those elements of their well-being. But like you mentioned, the spiritual, the soul is an area that people are thinking about. And when we talk about, I think just in life, in our research for the Work Wellbeing book, when we do encounter transformative events in our life, whether they be traumatic or they cause us to rethink our priorities, and we've just had that on a mass scale with this global pandemic that everybody can relate to, that everyone talks about and knows about. And our research, when we asked Australians, are you spending more time doing some of these things? Our research found that almost half said they were spending more time thinking about the meaning of life, that almost half were thinking about their own mortality. A third were thinking more about God, and 28% said they were praying more. So it was reflected in our thoughts, or in the thoughts of many Australians, and even their actions as well. So it's certainly being reflected there in the research as to what you were sharing.
Yeah, totally. And, you know, it's just an area of life where people don't talk much about, or we think they don't. Our research shows that more than half of Australians say they talk about spiritual or religious things on occasion. So it used to be don't talk politics and religion. Certainly these days, people are happy to talk and tweet and social media their views on politics and religion and spirituality, particularly for an emerging generation, is one of those top conversational issues now. And I think that's excellent that, you know, people can reflect on these things. It's Tim Costello, who's a great Australian commentator and social impacts worker and reflects on these things, talks about soul sickness, that we in Australia, if we don't look after our soul in that sense and think about the spiritual well-being, yeah, we can end up with a sickness that flows out in our lives, in our families, communities, relationships. And so, you know, all of those areas are important in life.
Mm. And as you and I have just sort of been alluding to, we do talk about this aspect of our well-being, this spiritual aspect, this mental aspect, in terms of our holistic well-being. And in this time where people are thinking about purpose and meaning and reevaluating what is important to them, a big part of that is work. And our book is called Work Wellbeing, so we do talk a lot about that. And I wanted to read a quote that I just saw online from somebody called Brianna Wiest. And I think it's really interesting because I think it does encapsulate what we believe about wellbeing, that especially, I guess, in the context of work, that well-being is not just about standing desks or getting the right amount of exercise because you're in a sedentary role or in an office job. You know, when we think about well-being, sometimes we just think, oh, physical health. But it's so much more than that, as you said, about the spiritual as well. But her quote is, true self-care is not salt baths and chocolate cake, as great as those things are. It is making the choice to build a life you don't need to regularly escape from. And we conducted some research that I believe we even talked about on a previous episode, where we asked Australians about, if you'd never had to work again, if you won the lottery, you know, would you continue working? And it kind of gets to that nitty gritty about how they feel about work. And we talk a lot about how a sense of meaning and purpose can contribute to your work well-being. And yeah, it's something that we love to talk about, and we spoke a lot about it in the book. And I even love a quote that we put in there, which said, many young people leave jobs not because there is a compelling reason to leave, but because there is no compelling reason to stay. So a sense of purpose and meaning in work can also lead to attracting and retaining great talent. So that helps the employee as well as the employee feeling like they have a sense of meaning and purpose. I mean, do you have anything else to add to that, Mark, in terms of how a sense of meaning and purpose that people are thinking about at the moment does contribute to our work well-being?
Yeah, and the work is a key place. Someone's vocation, someone's role is a key means through which they find that well-being and are fulfilled in their purpose. And that survey that you mentioned about, you know, if you won the lottery, what would you do? Quit work, you know, quit your job. I was encouraged to see that only a small proportion would quit their job and never work again. A number would say, well, look, if money wasn't the issue, I'd quit my job, but I wouldn't quit work because work is not the money, the remuneration is not the only reason that I work. You know, it is a means of achieving purpose and growth and contributions and relational connection. And indeed, the majority of people said, even if money was taken care of through that scenario of winning the lottery and having, you know, millions in spare there, I wouldn't quit work. I would maybe readjust the hours, but I would stay. The majority of Australians said they would still work. Such is the important place that it has in our life. And I was encouraged by that for many, work is a key aspect of life through which they grow and find purpose and make contributions and are able to serve and contribute to the lives of others. It's fantastic. And that's why in some other research we ran, we found that the number one sector of employment in Australia now, some decades ago, was manufacturing. More recently, it was the retail sector. But now by total headcount, it's the not-for-profit sector. You know, more Australians work for charities than any other specific sector, which tells me a lot about the motivations there. It's that they want to work in a place where there are values and where they're having impacts and where it's for a cause, for a purpose, which the for-purpose sector is really all about. And even though those individuals could probably earn more by working for a commercial place up the road, they're choosing the not-for-profit place because they're valuing the contributions, the impacts, the purpose more than the remuneration and that job security. So yeah, that was a great vote of well done to Australians who really are bringing well-being, purpose and meaning into even their employment situation.
Absolutely. And there's been a lot of talk in recent years about mental health, and you alluded to that a few answers ago in terms of it's a widespread issue. And we talk about it in our Generation Alpha book, where we talk about this even next generation of children and some of the challenges they're facing and the context they're being shaped in. A lot of people we spoke to and we researched were talking about the fact that they think this next generation will grow up with greater mental health challenges. And in our work wellbeing book, we've got this little kind of work wellbeing wheel, or wellbeing reel rather, where we talk about those different aspects of our wellbeing. And as you mentioned earlier, you know, it is holistic and it's multifaceted. We talk about mental, emotional and spiritual and purpose and security and relational and all these different aspects that fit into different sort of areas, like our personal well-being, our interpersonal well-being, our financial and our vocational. So it's complex. It's more than, like we said with that quote, it's more than just salt baths or eating chocolate cake or having, you know, an afternoon off or whatever it might be. It's holistic. But with regards to mental health and well-being, Mark, do you think a sense of purpose and meaning can help when it comes to our mental health and the challenges that we are facing in sort of a society and for the emerging generations?
Yeah, totally. You know, it's such an important aspect of that wheel. And, you know, we deliberately made it a wheel for a reason, that, you know, people might have 10 out of 10 on some aspects of that wheel, some sectors of that wheel. You know, their job security is going well, the earnings are going well, you know, maybe the relational world is going well, but there's a flat spot on the purpose, or there's nothing really in the impacts or the contributions to others. Well, that wheel is not going to function very well. As great as some parts of the wheel are going, it's going to not spin very well if it's got very low spots in others. So it is about that holistic perspective. It is about ensuring that we have, you know, a good result in all of those areas to really help life function. And the purpose is a key one, not only because it's one of those aspects, but in a lot of ways, it gives emphasis and perhaps leverage to all of the others. You know, if someone has a lot of money, but they don't have purpose as to what they're doing with that or why, then that suddenly is not a particularly solid and motivating area. And so, yeah, purpose and meaning does sit behind most of those aspects. And it brings me to a reflection in Viktor Frankl's book, Man's Search for Meaning. Viktor Frankl, the doctor who had that terrible situation where he was imprisoned in Auschwitz concentration camp, and remarkably one of the few who survived that tragedy, that Holocaust. And he went and wrote this book on his release, and he says in the book, the one who has a why to live can bear with almost any how. And there's power in that. The why helps us get through the how or the what or the context, if that why is big enough. So that's the purpose, that's the meaning, and it is core to resilience. It is the means by which we forge character that won't collapse at the ill winds that blow towards us. It is what creates in our lives example and helps us to raise children or to help others that are going through tough times endure as well. The purpose, the meaning, the why to live, in Viktor Frankl's words, is essential.
Absolutely. And I was reflecting on, as you were sharing that answer, just around my next question is about the future generations and how important a role purpose and meaning plays for them. And I was reflecting as well on some research that we conducted last year where we asked Australians about the biggest negative impact of COVID-19 on their life. And for many Australians, especially younger Australians, they were saying it was a mental impact, that it's had a negative impact on them mentally, social isolation, rapid time of change, and that Viktor Frankl quote you were saying, just in terms of the why can anchor you in times of rapid change and can be a constant as the world shifts. And I guess we've just seen the importance of that over the last couple of years. And I guess it makes sense then that for younger generations who haven't lived as much life, who haven't maybe encountered as many seasons of disruption or change, something like a pandemic where it throws out all of their plans and social calendar and some of those surface level things that might not be considered as important but are for that life stage, can certainly have an impact on them. So we know from our research that the younger generations are a more purpose-driven generation in some ways. And I loved what you shared in our previous episode about the generations defined and giving some encouragement to Generation Z, because sometimes, you know, the youth of today can get lumped with being lazy or being entitled, but actually there's another side to that story. And even from our research, the top desire among Generation Z for their future career is to have purpose and meaning in their work, which is incredible. So how important a role do you think purpose and meaning is playing for this emerging generation already that we're seeing come through?
Yeah, it is so key. You know, it's again, not just important, it is essential. And for this next generation, they are saying, well, I expect it in work. You know, maybe in the past, because we've always wanted purpose and meaning, people would say, sure, you know, work, I can't expect to fulfill all of those areas, so I'll get meaning outside and that will give me the balance in life. But young people are saying, well, if the majority of our waking hours are spent at work and more of the years of our life there, then I want to make sure that it also is achieving meaning and purpose and values alignment and impact as well. And I think that's fantastic that they're bringing that expectation to the employment situation, to the workplace. And, you know, probably wouldn't be a complete discussion on meaning and purpose without bringing up Abraham Maslow's hierarchy of human needs, that I'm sure we all remember that pyramid. And what's great about it is young people are saying, look, of course, the survival and the security issues down the bottom of that pyramid, that matters. So we need to earn the money. We need to have money for a rainy day. We need to pay the bills. We need a roof over our heads. Of course, that's important. But they're quickly moving up to that third rung of the social, you know, that relational side of life. And then the fourth one, the self-esteem, where they can grow and expand their skills and develop themselves. And of course, that highest one, the self-actualization, which is about giving back and contributions. And we see now this generation living that out and bringing that expectation to even others in the workplace, where they're looking at workplace giving programs or the triple bottom line of organizations, making sure that they're in an organization that is diverse and living true to the values and having impacts in the community where they're planted. All of those aspects, I think, are really healthy for the organization, for obviously the people involved, but for our community and society. So I think we have a lot to thank this next generation for, who aren't just doing the old fair day's work for a fair day's pay, but are raising the standard of what work is about, bring a high view of vocation once more, and making sure that they do hold us all to account to deliver with the resources, the investment, the time, the human resources we all have, to bring a return on that for the betterment of society at large.
Absolutely. And I love what you shared with our team in recent times and in some presentations with clients. There's this quote that I've heard you say before, which has said, this is the options generation, talking about sort of school leavers and Generation Alpha, with unlimited pathways ahead of them, more career options than ever before, more career mobility with regards to their work. But we do them no favors to set them up with endless opportunities, but no purpose. And that idea that it is an incredible time of opportunity for a school leaver today, for a young person, but without that anchoring purpose or that constant, like you said, it helps to provide them with a sense of resilience when storms come and black swan events come and times change and their jobs change or the careers change or life events shift beneath them. But if they've got a purpose, they've got a sense of meaning that can help to, I think, help their career, but also their overall well-being in life, which is certainly important for a school leaver today, for someone entering, different stages of their life.
Yeah, I think that's so true. You know, we've discussed the generations in prior podcasts, but, you know, they are the superlative generation. You name the area, they're number one in terms of their size, in terms of their material wealth, in terms of their education, the technology and the global connection, and, you know, the top of the tree and all of that. And that's what you'd expect, you know, and each generation really inherits what the previous generation set up for them. And hopefully that trend will continue with the one coming after. But with all of that endowment and investment and opportunity comes responsibility. And I'm glad to see this generation picking that up and saying, well, we do want, therefore, that meaning, that purpose. We don't want to inherit all of this stuff, receive all of this stuff, and just enjoy it ourselves. We want to think about what contributions can we make because of this incredible start, being in this era at this time with all these opportunities and being young. What can we steward of all of this to bring about the benefit for others? And that's a great way of thinking. And that's what this generation are bringing to their work.
And it's a great quality about them. And I think something that certainly should be celebrated. So well done to any of those Gen Zs listening. If you identify with that, you know, that's fantastic. A final question, Mark, in light of all of the things we've talked about today with purpose and meaning in regards to our overall well-being, as well as our work well-being, do you have any advice or tips for people, I guess, in the current context, maybe thinking of reevaluating their priorities or their life or their work, but also maybe those younger generations that we just spoke about who are embarking on their careers, who are looking to have more meaning and purpose in their work? How do they reconcile some of those things that you mentioned with regards to that the Maslow's hierarchy of needs? There's different competing elements there. What advice do you have, say, for a school leaver today or someone changing their careers with regards to wanting to have more meaning and purpose in their life and their work?
Well, firstly, take advantage of this opportunity, whether it be the full stop, the blank page that we've been presented, or whether it be young people starting with the blank page as they move from learning and into the employment side of life. Take advantage of this situation to really plan out, to think about what they want. Now, that theoretical thinking, planning, curating won't necessarily play out perfectly in the real world, but at least it gets on the page or in our mind what the priorities are, what we're looking for. Again, back to being the examined life, because that is the life worth living. And so be intentional in that regard. Take advantage of this situation and this life stage and do some of that planning, thinking, prioritizing. Secondly, I would say, you know, be flexible as you go, because the plan on the page is not going to play out perfectly in the real world, complex as it may be, and curveballs and dead ends and challenges that come. But if we can keep reflecting back and reassessing, that's important. When I go bush sometimes with a compass, navigating through uncharted terrain, you're following the compass, but sometimes you can end up a little bit off course, and you do from time to time what's called a back bearing, where you sort of look at where you were and you look at where you are and you say, hey, am I still on track? And I think that's helpful as well. We've got a plan when we begin, but we take a back bearing from time to time to check that we're still on track, because as those of us that have been through a few decades in life and career know, we can have slippage. You know, we can end up 5, 10, 20 degrees from where we had planned without even realizing it. So reflection and looking back is an important thing. And thirdly, I'd say be that example. You know, hopefully that's what motivates us in life, is to be that exemplar for others, is to encourage and mentor others, is to bring others with us. And that does require a life that is worth following, or at least lessons and examples that we can point to that hopefully will be of benefit to others as well. And I think that gives good motivation. That's what's behind leadership. That's why we manage. That's why we build things, so that others can come in and hopefully take what we've built and build anew from there. And that's a good motivation for us. If it's all just about us, if we are the sum total, the purpose, the means, and the ends, that's not very fulfilling. Hopefully we recognize that's a little bit of a negative cycle and isn't really going to bring about some broader impacts beyond our own existence. So young people have this incredible opportunity to plan and to keep their eye on the goal and to look back and reflect and to be exemplars for others, or at least track a pathway for others. And that gives great meaning and purpose and has that enduring impact. And I feel, and I know you do as well, Ashley, the research we've done, that this generation will do that well. We have great cause for optimism as we've seen early signals of where they're headed.
Mm, and that's such great advice. Like you mentioned, for a school leaver today, but also for those of us who are leading school leavers today or the next generation, but also, I guess, for our own careers, whatever stage of life you're at, whatever phase of your career you find yourself in at the moment, it is a very unique time for that opportunity to reevaluate, but also to have flexibility, as we all have realized we've needed to have resilience in these times of great change, but also, yeah, to look outwards and to think of others and to be an example and to mentor and to give advice, like you've just done so eloquently for us in the podcast today, Mark. So thank you again for the chat. A little bit of a deeper topic today, but a delight nonetheless to have you. So thank you.
Oh, thanks, Ash.
And coming up, we've got some great future episodes planned featuring our new research and trends to talk about. And for more insights, if you're curious to find out more, you can always subscribe to the Future Report podcast. You can watch the video recording on YouTube or Spotify. Visit McCrindle.com, or you can follow us on socials. Also, make sure you hit follow on Spotify or Apple Podcasts so that you get updates on when we release a new episode every Wednesday. And if you are enjoying the podcast, we'd love to hear from you. We'd love for you to leave a review as well on Apple Podcasts so that others can find out about it. So thanks again for listening, and bye for now.